Welcome to Trinity 12. Let's get in the mood for thankfulness, the next in our series reflecting on what it means to walk as a follower of the way, the name first given to followers of Jesus. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you, for he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people. Give heed to me, my nation. For a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens, and look at the earth beneath, for the heavens will vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. Israel, once flowing with milk and honey, had become pretty desolate during the 70 years of the nation's captivity in Babylon, 586 BC. But through Isaiah, God had promised to restore the land. It would be productive again, and the desert bloom. There would be joy and gladness and songs of thanksgiving in the land. Now God is speaking to the remnant, or the drizzle of exiles that will return from Babylon. Were they going to be so discouraged that their nation, their land and their temple had been so destroyed that it would feel like a desert, a wilderness, a waste place? Listen to me is God's urgent summons to wake up and smell the coffee. All is not lost. How important will it be that God says to them, look to your roots and remember my promises. They will be a demoralized remnant. The origin of their very existence is God's promise to Abraham and Sarah. They are the reason God is renewing his promises to the returning few. Despite the last 70 years and the destruction of everything, they are still his people. God will establish his law, his instruction again, as he did in the early days of their existence in the glory days of Moses. You see, he says, my sovereignty is overarching, far-reaching, long-term. Unlike the earth and the heavens, which will vanish, wear out and die, my salvation will be forever, and that means there will be a future on and beyond even the apparently history-ending cataclysmic events you have experienced in watching your nation, your land, crumble. Now, is God just speaking to the exiles that Isaiah is envisioning in the dim distance of the future? Or is he speaking to us too, through Isaiah? As followers of Jesus, our origins are also in Abraham. We show that we are spiritual children of Abraham when we demonstrate the same faith as he did. And in that way, we are inheritors of all that God promised Abraham and Sarah. Read that in Galatians. However, since Pentecost, there's something even more dynamic than that. God has actually made us his children through his indwelling Holy Spirit, if you like. We are hewn from the Trinity. Father, Son and Holy Spirit, as Israel was hewn from Abraham and Sarah. This is a video of when we were in Jordan, and it's just so dry. The desert, you can understand why the people asked Moses for water. The desert becoming fruitful can only be a work of God. Ultimately, what is going to happen to creation, as we know it now, is that it will vanish like smoke, wear out like a garment. Its inhabitants will die like gnats. Instead of waste places and wilderness and desert will be God's new Eden, where there is joy and gladness and thanksgiving in the voice of song, and we will be part of that new creation forever. So I guess to be thankful is to live in the light of that reality. And that's what rescue or salvation means. If that is the fate of the world, then we are indeed rescued. To be thankful is, it's from an idea that includes extending the hand, it's offering something to someone, it's acknowledging where things come from. It all depends when you say thank you as to what it means. If you say thank you before something has happened, then you're implying you're trusting the person to deliver what they've promised. It's a statement of trust. Thank you very much. The psalmist does it often. You know it will happen. If you say thank you after something good has happened, you're expressing gratitude. Thank you very much. The opposite of thankfulness is criticism, judgmentalism, discontent, muttering, grumbling. You can't be these things and be thankful at the same time. You can only have one expression on your face. Take a moment to look in the mirror. What's yours right now? God's consistent problem with Israel in the escape from Egypt and the trek through the desert was that she grumbled all the time, about everything. There were a few named people who didn't, but on the whole, that was the ethos of the trek. Israel's journey from Egypt to the Promised Land could have been completed in a few weeks. Even a huge crowd moving with herds of cattle and sheep across an untracked desert wilderness wouldn't have taken 40 years. Instead, Israel did spend 40 years on the wilderness trek simply because she did nothing but grumble, and that's how God felt about it. For when we think about God, it would be very easy to say God was good and to be thankful for when good things happen. But with God, he is good all the time, whether we perceive good things happening or not. Because God is changeless, because he can be trusted, because of who he is, we can be thankful whatever the circumstances. My grandma was ill with cancer in Hastings back in the 1970s. She didn't have a phone. There was no way that my mum could get to know what was going on, except by visiting. So she went from North London to Hastings twice a week by train. It was something she wanted to do, but it became quite physically and emotionally exhausting. As you can imagine, there was a moment when my mum, because she read the Bible morning and evening as her anchor point, she read this. She read 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 18. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Give thanks in all circumstances became her life's motto. Her spiritual life changed. She experienced God's presence and his provision because of her obedience, as she put this maxim into practice moment by moment, day by day. Thankfulness somehow released energy. She wasn't tiring herself out with being negative or critical or judgmental. When Mum was finally in a care home with advancing Parkinson's long after Grandma died, how did she cope with it? She was thankful in it because thankfulness had just become a habit of life. You couldn't have met a more positive person than my mum. Oh, Grandma, by the way, came to live with Mum and Dad in New Barnet and died there, but that's another story. I believe that Paul was describing in this verse not the circumstances as God's will. They aren't always God's will in our mixed up world, but that we are to give thanks in them all. It's not that we're escaping from the moment, it's that God is in the middle of the moment, and that makes us thankful. We can share it with somebody. One translation of the Bible puts it like this: Be cheerful no matter what. Pray all the time. Thank God no matter what happens. This is the way God wants you, who belong to Christ Jesus, to live. The fact is that nothing passes God by, and that he can turn everything for his own good purposes. And that gives us reason for being thankful. Thankfulness isn't dependent on circumstances then, because it doesn't start there. It starts with contemplating who God is. In Psalm 50, Asaph, one of David's temple musical directors, tells us about two ways in which God asks us to bring him into our everyday lives. We can call on him in the day of trouble and bring him thanksgiving. In fact, bringing God thanksgiving honours him. Prayer is supposed to have an element of thanksgiving in it. Paul again, Philippians this time, says we're to make requests of God with thanksgiving. It's an implied statement of confidence in God's wisdom, love and power. It's not that we're suppressing our natural reactions, that would be unhealthy. It's choosing to develop the habit of asking the Holy Spirit within to exercise his power. The Christian thing has never been about grit your teeth, dig your nails into your hands, and try harder. Yes, it is about taking up our cross, following Jesus, but it's different nails we experience. It's standing aside from ourselves and allowing the Holy Spirit to live his life through us instead. Believe me, it feels like crucifixion sometimes, but it's the only way we can live out the risen life of Jesus. It's the life of the kingdom. It's the life of the kingdom to come. God reckons that if we get the heart right, we get the rest right. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, Jesus said wisely. A thankful heart means a thankful life, thankful speech, thankful face. Jesus also said, "Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." That's Matthew 5. Good works start with trusting God. What must we be doing to do the works of God? And somebody asked Jesus and he said, believing in me. There's nothing that's going to shine out more brightly in today's world than being thankful. Try it out this week.
Save your soul and found thee.
God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness. Increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.